Church, Happy New Year. We're so glad that you joined us this morning. Wherever you're at, we're going to start off with some worship. We want you to join in with us.
Come on and lift Yes, you have. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will see of the goodness of God. You stood closer than a brother, Lord. All my life you have been faithful. My present help, Lord. All my life you have been so, so good. But every breath of your goodness, it's all over my life. Oh, it's all over my life. My confidence is in this. I've seen your promises in fulfillment. Yes, Lord, it's all over my life. Oh, it's all over my life. I can't ignore who you are, Lord Jesus. I see the evidence of your good. God, I see evidence of your goodness. It's all over my life. It's all over my life. I see your promises, Lord Jesus. I see promises in fulfillment. It's all over my life, yeah. It's all over my life.
Father God, today we're reminded of the pursuit of your goodness, that you pursue us with that. And God, we just want to take a moment right now, wherever we are at home, in our cars, wherever we find ourselves, we want to take a moment to think of the evidences of your goodness this past year in our lives. God, we just take this moment, help us to remember those things. God, we're so grateful for your kindness because we don't deserve it. We're so grateful for your compassion because we don't deserve it. We're so grateful for the hope that is in you today. Thank you, Jesus, for that reminder. We love you so much. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, church. Thanks so much for joining us for Church Online. And whether you're watching from the comfort of your home or you're traveling with your family, we are just so glad that you're here. My name's Tyler. I serve as one of the pastors here. And if you are new around here, we would love to get to know you, put a gift in your hand, and answer any questions that you may have. So all you have to do is click on that little QR code right there. We'll get that gift sent to you. And if you have questions, we'll be able to answer them as well. Also, if you're watching right now with your kids, you may not know this, but we have content especially created for your kids. They will absolutely love it. You can go to our website, click on the Kids tab, and watch our Church Online right there for your kids. Okay, I hope you had an awesome Christmas, and it is unbelievable to think about that tomorrow is the first day of 2024. So let me be the first one to wish you perhaps a happy new year. And I also want to invite you back here next Sunday in person or online to join us for a new series that we start next week called Renew. We're going to be looking at three ways to renew your spiritual health, your emotional health, and of course, your physical health in this new year. You do not want to miss that. And I can't wait to kick off the series next week with the number one habit for you to grow spiritually and be spiritually healthy. So join us for that. As we transition into our time of giving, I just want to start off by saying thank you. As your pastor, I want to thank you for remembering CPC in your year-end giving. I want to thank you for your ongoing generosity to us. I want to remind you something that you may not know, that we count on, we plan for, and we prayerfully expect God to bring in 25% of our annual general fund budget in the month of December. So I do want to encourage you to remember CPC in your year-end giving. But as you do, let me encourage you with some things that we're here to celebrate that God has done in and through our church because of you in the last year. The first thing is this. 221 people took yes packets. That's a packet indicating they made a commitment to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior in the last year because of you. 97 people celebrated their baptism in and through our church because of you in the last year. We welcome 112 new families to our CPC Kids Ministries just in 2023 in the last year. And over 1,100 men and women meet in weekly Bible studies to grow in their discipleship here in the last year on average. And all of that is because of you and your generosity. And finally, one more thing I want to encourage you with. You probably know that we support and have partnerships with missions organizations here in the Bay Area and, of course, all around the world. And I want to tell you one that I found out just this last week that's something that I knew would encourage you. And that is with an organization called 360 Serve. Through them and through our For the World initiative, we partner with them and we sponsor over 200 Indian church planters. This is in the country of India, where the gospel is doing amazing things. And I found out last week that the number of people that have come to Christ because of those 200 Indian church planters, and we have names recorded of these people, would you believe in the last year, is 50,607. That's 50,607 people who have come to faith in the Lord who will be in heaven forever because of you and your generosity. So I hope those quick little stories and updates just encourage you as you consider how you might support the ministry in and through CPC. And so let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to worship you, even online, through music and through message, and of course through joining you and co-laboring you with you through generosity and giving. God, I invite your Holy Spirit to work right now in our hearts. Would you build in us this desire to be generous and joyful and cheerful givers? Would you increase these offerings that we receive 30, 60, 100-fold? And may they accomplish all the good purposes that you have in mind for them to accomplish. We thank you for everything you've done, way more than we listed, the life transformation through following you that has happened in CPC and through CPC over the last year, 2023. And we trust you for incredible fruit beyond as we continue to reach people and follow Jesus in 2024. God, we thank you, we love you. We pray all these things in the powerful name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen.
Good morning, church. I hope that you are having a wonderful New Year's Eve this morning. And I hope that you are with people that you love, and wherever you are and whoever you're with, you hear our church staff wishing you a very happy New Year. This morning, our teaching text is going to come from the book of Ecclesiastes, beginning in chapter 3. So if you have a Bible with you, grab it. If not, pull up Ecclesiastes chapter 3 on your phone and follow along with me, beginning in verse 1. Join me in the reading of God's word. The teacher writes, "For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pick up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the busyness that God has given everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds. Yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in their toil. I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor anything taken from it. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before him. That which is already has been. That which is to be already is, and God seeks out what has gone by." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This New Year's Eve weekend is one of my favorite weekends of the year, and I'm not just saying that, I really do mean it. Likely right about now, I'm sitting in Sid's Bagelry in Tahoe City like I do every year on December 31st. And I've got a cup of coffee, a gluten-free bagel with some lox and some schmear, and I've got my Bible, and I've got my journal. And my tradition every year is I sit down at the end of the year and I look back at what God did this year. I revisit the hopes and the dreams and the expectations I carried into the year. And then I spend time and I look forward. And I revisit and I reimagine what the next year could look like. I try and set my expectations for the year, make my goals, do what most people do at the start of the year. And I tell you, as I've done this over the years, what I find is that it quickly has become something I look forward to. I see all of the incredible, unexpected ways that God breaks into my year and surprises me. When I look back, I find more surprises than I do answers to the expectations that I had. So here are some of the highlights, the unexpected highlights from 2023 that I wanted to share with you. Here's the first one. Maggie and I learned how to fly fish. We picked up a new hobby this year. I had a fly rod and I had done it once or twice before, but Maggie and I committed to going up to the river in Tahoe and learning how to do this as a way to spend time together, as a way to be outside in nature and enjoy God's good earth, and as a time and a way to learn something new. It was awesome, so unexpected. I had no plans of picking up fly fishing in 2023. Another thing, I went to Hawaii for the first time. At the end of last year, I had no expectation or thought that I might go to Hawaii. But we went to Hawaii for Thanksgiving and it was my first time and it blew my mind. Maggie and I were hoping to buy a house either in Walnut Creek or in San Ramon, but unexpectedly this last year, God brought us the right house here in Danville. And we are so thrilled. That's been a great part of this last year. And as I've been looking back, I am so surprised at the ways in which God continues to blow my mind and to bring good things into life. Now, it wasn't all puppies and kittens. There were some hard moments that were unexpected, but I saw God do beautiful things through those as well. And I can tell you, the list goes on and on. We welcomed a nephew. Our puppy learned how to swim and stopped barking at the vacuum cleaner. Like, there's so many different things that happened this last year. But as I sat with my list, it actually reminded me something true about myself, something that I think is true about all of us. I'm someone who is driven by my expectations. I don't think I'm alone in that. I think human beings are people and creatures with expectations for everything, aren't we? When we look ahead, we set an expectation for what we hope happens, and then we work towards making that expectation a reality. And if we're honest, we make a lot of decisions based on our expectations about how things should be. Like, how many of you put up the Christmas tree on Friday after Thanksgiving? I gotta tell you, that is one of my expectations. Every year, the Christmas tree goes up on Friday. Not Thursday, not on Thanksgiving, definitely not before Thanksgiving, not even when we're gonna be away for Thanksgiving and my wife comes and says, honey, can we please put it up before we leave for Hawaii? I'm ashamed to say, I looked at her and said, Maggie, a man has to have some principles and the tree should not go up before Thanksgiving. That's my expectation of what we're gonna do moving forward. And she laughed and she understood, I think. But this is true. We set our actions based on our expectations. We also learn expectations from other people. Consider some of these proverbs that I heard growing up. How about this one? The early bird gets the worm. We say this to teach kids that they should get after something early, that if they want it, they should go pursue it, that if you wait and you procrastinate, it bites you in the butt. Or how about this one? Maybe I'm sensitive to this as a man, but most of us men heard this growing up. Boys don't cry, right? That's an expectation that when you are faced with a moment of sadness and grief, many men have a really hard time crying. Using one of the gifts God has given us, our tears and our emotions, to help shed some of the weight of a season of grief. Or another one, actions speak louder than words. We set the expectation that if you want to know what someone thinks, you shouldn't listen necessarily to what they say, you should see what they do. And it sets us up to mistrust people's words because we're focusing on their actions. That's an expectation that we carry forward into our lives, and it colors how we live. Here's another important one, another important proverb. Jesus loves, how do you fill in that blank? It matters how you fill that in because it matters then who you think Jesus loves. If you have an expectation that Jesus loves a certain group of people, you also have an expectation that Jesus might not love a certain group of people, and vice versa. Our expectations color how we act. Here's a humorous story to maybe illustrate some of this. Our expectations are shaped by our families. We learn expectations from our families. So my dad is from outside of New York City, and his mom was a New York Giants fan. So my dad was raised a New York Giants fan, and all of his friends were New York Giants fans. And the expectation was you would raise your kids to be Giants fans. That's how sports fandom works. So growing up, I became a New York Giants fan. My dad and I would watch games together. I saw David Tyreek's football helmet catch. Man, it was awesome in high school. And then all of a sudden, in college, the Giants went. And I was going to school in Washington where all of my friends were not Giants fans, so there was no commiseration that the Giants were bad. They were all Seahawks fans, and the Hawks were really good. They were going as the Giants were taking a decline. And so they would ask me at football games, hey, Ryan, why aren't you a Hawks fan? Why are you a Giants fan? Dude, come on, come join the dark side. And so one time I called my dad and said, Dad, I'm seriously considering becoming a Seahawks fan. I wanted to run this by you to see what you thought and to see if you had any advice for how I should choose which team to root for. My dad paused and humorously he said, well, I gotta tell you, Ryan, your sisters are really gonna like receiving your inheritance when you become a Seahawks fan. And we both laughed and then he said, no, in all seriousness, if you wanna figure out who you should root for, go watch a Giants game one last time. And if you don't love them, the expectation is that you would root for the team that you love. And I got to tell you, I watched the Giants play that afternoon, and every time Eli Manning dropped back and he went to throw a pass, my heart lifted. And then that night, I watched the Seahawks play, and when Russell Wilson would drop back, I just kept thinking, eh. And from that moment forward, I thought, okay, I'm in. I'm going to be a Giants fan. My expectation is I would root for the Giants no matter what season. And my wife knows this. Our kids will hopefully be raised Giants fans, despite my brother-in-law trying to make them Eagles fans. What are some of your expectations for life? Huh? Maybe it's who you thought you were going to marry, and that has colored how you've chosen to date. Or maybe it's what you want your kids to do with their lives moving forward, and so that influences how or what they're active in. Or maybe it's the kind of lifestyle that you want to have when you're retired, and that has influenced what you're doing with all of your money right now. What drives those decisions? I bet as you dig into this, you will find that your expectations drive many of your decisions. Yet, so many of us are unaware of the expectations that we hold that drive our decisions. And this matters because our unexpressed expectations result in unmet expectations. Our expectations matter because our unconscious, unexpressed, or unrealistic expectations always result in unmet expectations. And unmet expectations kill contentment within us. I'll give you another personal example about this. When I went to seminary, I was so excited. I'd never been to seminary before. I made the decision that I was going to go and I was going to study for 3 years to become a pastor. And in my head, I thought that was going to look like it had looked leading up to that moment, where I would sit and I would be in a Bible study with people and we would talk about big ideas and we would pray together and there would be harmony and we would do stuff and we would have fun. And then I got to seminary in New Jersey and man, my expectations were exposed and I realized that my unconscious expectation that seminary would be like a small group let me down when I realized that seminary was really hard work. And that other people didn't want to pursue the same things that I did, and they had their own expectations for what seminary could be. For some of them, it was a wrestling mat to prove their theological point. For others, it was like a stage for them to perform their brilliance. For me, I had a really hard time with that. And for a long time, I really considered what I was doing there. And people would ask me if I was okay, and I was feeling down. But what I would say is, no, I'm fine. Like, I'm fine. I'm hanging in there, I'm fine. But you know what fine means in those moments, right? I was freaked out, I was insecure, I was neurotic, I was emotional. When our expectations go unmet, they result in despair. The moment seminary changed for me was when a really wise third-year student who was about to graduate and go step into the pastorate pulled me aside. And we were buddies, and he knew a little bit more about how I was feeling. And he said to me, Ryan, I want to challenge you with something. I think your sadness and your frustration that your expectation for seminary isn't being met is getting in the way of you being able to recognize and live into God's expectations for what he wants for you in seminary. And he said, you can either keep trying to catch up and make your expectations a reality, or you can let go and you can submit to God's expectations for seminary and you can pursue those. Either way, you've got to change something because what you're doing is not working. Oh my gosh, that was a moment where God drilled me. And he challenged me in that moment to come to him with my expectations and check to make sure that they were in line with his. And if they weren't, to put my expectations down and to receive God's expectations. And this is the challenge that I want to lay before you as we stand on the precipice of 2024. We all carry expectations that we need to put down. And we need to receive from God his expectations. What would it look like to do this, to exchange our posture of expectation for God's expectations? How would that change in your daily life? What would that look like in your internal world? I know we need a guide through this, which is why we are teaching through Ecclesiastes chapter 3. So if you have your Bible, turn back to that text and we're going to start there. Ecclesiastes is a brilliant book of the Bible. The teacher who wrote Ecclesiastes was a master teacher of the way of God. And his whole point and purpose for writing this was to teach people the good life. What does it look like to live the best possible life? And he wrote his wisdom to challenge people where they thought was the good life and to present to them what God's good life actually is. This is his move all throughout his work. He begins with challenge, and then he offers another way of living. In fact, he actually opens his book up with these words. This is his opening salvo, his statement for what his book is. The words of the teacher, the son of David, king of Jerusalem, meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. On the surface, this is a pretty depressing beginning to a book of the Bible, isn't it? It's not hopeful. There's no real joy. How is meaningless a reflection of the good life of God? Where is Jesus in hearing that things are meaningless? But what the teacher's doing is he's starting his book off with a challenge, and he's setting out a picture of what our attempts at the good life are. Because that word meaningless, or in some Bibles it's vanity, is the Hebrew word chavel. And it means something more like trying to grasp onto smoke, trying to grab onto something that looks solid, but then when you touch it, it just slips through your fingertips. You can't actually grab it because it's smoke. It's not solid. This is the picture that the teacher gives to describe how life is like when we try and pursue our own way and we don't go to God for God's way. But instead of living life this way, constantly reaching after something and have it just flow through our fingertips, setting an expectation for the year that this is going to be the best year ever, and then things going absolutely haywire at the very start, the teacher invites us to something else. Instead of living life this way, constantly reaching after something that looks solid but we know actually isn't, why don't we actually reach out to God, who is solid, who is always present with us? When we do that, we are freed up from being constrained by our own expectations. And instead, we can live in a posture of expectancy. That's the teacher's invitation throughout the book of Ecclesiastes, and especially in chapter 3. Doesn't that sound like a great thing to pursue this year? If we look at the text, we see the teacher begin to repeat his pattern, presenting a challenge, offering a way forward. The teacher begins our text by resetting our expectations for us. He creates space for any type of season to come up. Look at how he opens chapter 3, verse 1. The teacher writes, "For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven." Or in other words, at any moment, our seasons can change. And then he lists out a list of different kinds of seasons, seasons that we'll see in our lives. Do you see the brilliance in what he does? It is hard to have an expectation for what you think the year is going to be when the teacher tells you there's a season for everything and every matter under heaven could happen. It's hard to be disappointed or let down or hemmed in by our expectations when the expectation is anything could happen. This list pretty much includes everything that could happen in 2024. There will be times of great joy this year and times of sorrow. Times where we see birth and experience death. We will see moments where we should speak up and moments where we should not, where we should be quiet. Our hearts will be wild with hope at certain moments, and at other moments, we will know the sting of despair and grief. If we choose to listen to the teacher, we will hear that holding a set expectation for a season is really challenging because it limits our field of view. And we become so hyper-focused on that, that it's really hard to see how God is moving in our midst. When we're so focused on where we want God to be moving, that we miss where God actually ends up moving. Do you know that God is never seemingly where we want him to be, at least where we're focused on with our expectations? God meets us where we actually are. You see, God cares way more about us than our expectations for life, which is why the teacher goes out of his way to challenge and then to defang our expectations and to point out that we can't really hold expectations with any certainty. This isn't meant to cause despair or to scare us. It's meant to cause us to reorient ourselves, to relocate ourselves, to come back to where we actually are. As if he's trying to understand us better and to pastor us well, the teacher then goes on to expose our expectations. And he asks this pivotal question in verse 9. He says, "What gain have the workers from their toil?" Or in modern words, what is the point of all of this work that we're doing if anything can change at any moment? I'll tell you, this is a pivotal moment where the teacher's saying, there's a way we can go where we're focused on what we hope, or there's a way moving forward where we're focused on what God could do in the midst of this. Robert Frost is a poet who speaks of a similar thing to this teacher in his poem, The Road Less Traveled. He writes, "Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both, and be one traveler, long I stood, and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent into the undergrowth, and then took the other just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear." Frost captures this moment where we find ourselves standing at a crossroads, where the road in front of us diverges. After reading those first 8 verses of chapter 9, the teacher brings us to a crossroad by asking this question, what do the workers gain from their toil? We can either keep toiling or there has to be another way. Another way to say this is we can keep trying to make our expectations our reality and failing, or we can step back and live life expectantly with God. They sound similar, but I promise they offer very different endpoints if you follow them. Let me show you. Let's stand with Robert Frost at this point where two roads diverged in a yellow wood. If we look down path one, the path where we keep trying to make our expectations a reality, we find that we're trying to control our life. And let me be clear, this does not lead to contentment, it leads to despair. And the teacher actually shows us this in Ecclesiastes. When he anticipates, we ask, why won't life work out the way I want or the way I hope it will? And so beginning in verse 9, he tells us, he says, "What gain have the workers from their toil? I, the teacher, have seen the busyness that God has given everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds. Yet they cannot figure out what God has done from the beginning to the end." His answer to that question, what gain do the workers have from their toil, is that every time humans try and grab onto certainty, try and understand things, we end up just grasping at smoke and seeing it flow through our fingertips. We end up in Havel. Not because we didn't try hard enough. You can grab smoke as hard as you can, but it's because God didn't design us that way to live. The scriptures say that God has given us the things that we're busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. He is the one who puts the sense of past and future into our head. Yet no matter how hard we try, we can never figure out what God has done from past from beginning to end. Why? Because understanding is God's role. When we try and understand why something's happening, when we try and understand what workers gain from their toil, we're sitting in God's seat. When we try and do God's job, the church has always said that that is pride, and pride is the root of all of their sin, because what pride is looking at God saying, I can do that better. When I read this text this week, man, I have to tell you, I was convicted of that. And I felt like the Holy Spirit asked me two questions that I want to pass on to you. First question, where are we trying to be God in our lives? Or more specifically, where are you trying to be God in your life? And the second is like it, why? Why are you trying to be God in that way? Is it because you're afraid that if you don't work really hard or control everything around you, that everything's gonna fall apart? Or did you ask God to do something in the past and you didn't get it, but you thought you should have, so now you don't want to ask God for things because you might not get them? Or do you sense an absence from God? And that makes your heart heavy. Whatever it is, bring that reason to mind. And then hear the teacher offer us a different way to walk, a way that actually leads to life. Here, as we're standing at those two roads diverging in a yellow wood, one leads to despair, the other leads to God, it leads to life. Here it is. It's living life with a posture of expectancy and releasing control to God. It looks like going from asking God, why is this happening, to Lord, where are you at work in the midst? Again, it's a subtle shift. But when we ask why, we're trying to control a situation, or at least retain control. But when we ask where, what we're doing is we're opening ourselves up to God, inviting God into our experience, into every season of life, times where we are seeing birth, times where we're seeing death, times where we're experiencing love and times we're experiencing hate, times where we see war and times we're experiencing peace. We will never know why to a level that satisfies. I hate to burst your bubble, but it's true. You will never understand to a level that satisfies you, because that's not something that humans can do. That's only God's role. No right answer will ever convince us that grief, war, hardship, poverty, racism, injustice are somehow understandable. They're just not. The only thing that makes them understandable is that we live in a broken and bent world. And the answer to that brokenness and that bentness is not a knowledge answer. We live in a knowledge society. If we know it, then we can fix it. It's a result of philosophy and technology and different things. But I'm promising you, what the church has proclaimed since the church began is that we do not have a knowledge problem. We have a relational problem. You don't have a knowledge problem, you have a relational problem. Asking why is a knowledge question. Asking where is a relational question. And when we ask where, we open ourselves up to receive God, to receive and to see and to recognize all of the different ways that he's at work around us. If we want to walk on this second path, we have to be willing to put down our expectations and step into a posture of expectancy. To stop asking and looking for answers to the question why, and to start looking for where God is at work in our midst. Because the answer to the brokenness of this world is always begins and ends with relationship to God. That is the true desire of our hearts, is to be with God. We can endure all things through Christ who gives us strength. Without Christ, we can do nothing, but with him, we can do all things. Or a different translation says, we can get through everything with God's help. C.S. Lewis reflects a little bit more deeply on this thought in his book, Mere Christianity. He says, if I find in myself a desire, which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world. If none of my earthly pleasures satisfy this desire, that does not prove that the universe is a fraud. Probably earthly desires were never meant to satisfy this desire, but simply to arouse it, to suggest the real thing. If that is so, I must take care. On the one hand, never to despise or to be unthankful for these earthly blessings. And on the other, never to mistake them for something else which they are only a copy of, an echo of, a mirage of. I must keep alive in myself the desire for my true country and to help others around me do the same. The teacher says something similar this way, beginning in verse 13. He says, I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor anything taken from it. God has done this, so all should stand in awe before him. That which is already has been, that which is to be already is, and God seeks out what is gone by. A Christian worldview is something that believes that life is a gift from God. That God's gift is that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in him. And although we have a sense of this past and future, and God created us to be aware of how things are not how we want them to be, they're never meant to inspire in us an ability to control. We don't have that. That past and present that God has put into our head, this sense of expectation, those are meant to drive us to God. Like C.S. Lewis said, that's a desire that nothing in this world is going to satisfy except for God. And so our call as Christians is to walk towards that. This perspective, I promise you, changes how we approach life. It changes how we approach seasons of suffering and grief because it challenges our assumption that God is somewhere else. Instead, when we ask why, or when we ask where in these moments, we begin to find that God is actually the God who has stepped towards us. When we're expectant that God is going to show up, we recognize him in places we never thought he would be. In the spilled milk and the temper tantrum of your toddler, in not getting the promotion and that sense of failure that you feel, in the cancer diagnosis that makes all of the hope from the last couple of years seem hopeless, in your grief that your beloved is no longer present with you. There's a reason that Jesus describes those who mourn as blessed in Matthew chapter 4, when he says, blessed are those that mourn, for they will be comforted. Because when we're mourning, God draws near to us. But unless we ask the right question and have the right perspective, we don't end up in a place where we're able to receive God's comfort. When we're asking God why they died, as opposed to, Lord, where are you comforting me? It's hard to receive the comfort Christ offers. And this is the hope of Christmas, that God drew near to us in our deepest need. That God recognized that we needed him to draw near to us. And so in Advent, we celebrate that God drew near as a baby. And he answered our question of God, where are you, with right beside you. We celebrate that at Christmas every year. But on the heels of Christmas, we step out of the liturgical season of Advent into what is known as ordinary time. And it's hard to take this wonder and this assuredness that we receive during Christmas that Christ drew near to us and to carry that with us in the time between Christmases, isn't it? When we enter back into this daily life, God sends us out on mission to live out the hope of Christmas into a time of year where most people forget about that. And he invites us to look for the Messiah who promised that he would never leave us nor forsake us. So church, God invites us again and again as his people to take him at his word. His word that he speaks to us in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, that God's gift is that everybody should eat, drink, and be merry, living life with him. his word that he says in Matthew chapter 11, beginning in verse 28, where he says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." As you head into 2024, my prayer for you is that you begin to lay down expectation and you begin to take up a posture of expectancy, opening your hearts to what God might do in your midst this year and then keeping a watch, looking out for where God is at moving in your midst and in the lives of the people that you're surrounded by. Because I promise you, God has not left us alone in our lives. We just celebrated that at Christmas. And as we look ahead towards Easter, we will celebrate that God ultimately has never left us nor forsaken us. And his Holy Spirit dwells within each one of us. That is the good news that the church has to offer. So whatever season you find yourself in, wherever you are this year, may I invite you to a posture of expectancy. So we might be like Robert Frost, who said, "When two roads diverged in a yellow wood, I took the road less traveled." And that has made all the difference. Choosing to let go of control and to embrace God is the path that is less traveled. And I promise you, it makes all the difference. So this year, church, may we be a people who choose to let go of our expectations and to stop asking why in the midst of all of our many seasons, and to pick up and put on a posture of expectancy and to come to God asking, "Lord, where are you?" And may that make a difference for us this year. Would you pray with me? God, I thank you for being the God of presence, that you are the God who draws near, that you are the God who loves. Would you, in all things, speak to each one of the people who are attending and watching and listening to this word today? Speak to them through your scriptures and invite them, teach them, show them how to put on your expectancy. And so, Lord, as we're praying before you, church, I would invite you, put your hands out in front of you with two fists closed, palms facing the ground. And think of expectation as something that you're holding. And open your hands and release that into the Father's grasp. And then turn your hands over, hands still open, palms facing the sky now, and receive Christ's presence with you. Receive the posture of expectancy that the church is able to have as we wait for Christ to come, because he promised, "I have come once and I am coming again." And so, Lord, we close with the ancient prayer of the church that we find in Revelation. Come, Lord Jesus, come. All God's people said, amen. Happy New Year, everybody.